Good afternoon. The first item of business this afternoon is Scottish Parliamentary Corporate Body Questions. Question number one, John Finney.
Okay, thank you, President Officer. To ask the Scottish Parliamentary Corporate Body how it promotes the Parliament, its values and its work.
Liz Smith.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. The Scottish Parliament Corporate Body promotes the Parliament, its values and its work through supporting members in our work and also through the work of a number of offices across the Parliament working together to deliver a public engagement strategy. Increasingly, I think we are seeing the direct benefits of this engagement work in the scrutiny of the Parliament's committees, and perhaps I think the most visible recent example of success in this area is the way in which the BSL Bill was improved as a direct result of the Parliament developing a very close working relationship with Scotland's deaf and deafblind community.
Many thanks. John Finney.
Thank you. I thank the member for that response and indeed the commendable work that is taking place. Lockheed Martin are the world's largest arms company and they've been given money by the Scottish Government. They've also been given publicity by the Scottish Parliament when they provided a prize for an award ceremony in this building. The Green Independent Group raised that issue and we were advised in a response that they were a public sector supplier of IT systems. The member will be aware that daily there's increasing concerns about pension investment. Regret, nothing suggests that the Parliamentary Corporate Body or indeed the pension trustees recognise that. Recently we debated Trident, yet we invest in a company supplying propulsion system. Would the member agree that it's time for the Scottish Parliament to accept responsibility for our own affairs and not hide behind pension fund managers? Time to sort out our customer-client relationship with these fund managers and divest from arms, fossil fuels and tobacco. And will the Scottish Parliamentary Corporate Body agree to undertake and make public a risk assessment of the reputational damage such arrangements, associations, funding are causing to an institution I know we all hold very dearly?
Liz Smith.
Could I thank the member for his supplementary and also recognise his long-standing interest in this issue. Can I just be absolutely clear about this, that under the Scottish Parliamentary Pensions Act of 2009, the day-to-day administration, including any investment strategy for the Scottish Parliament Pension Scheme, that is the sole responsibility of the fund trustees and not actually of the corporate body. And I understand that the fund trustees, who are appointed obviously by Bailey Gifford as fund manager for the scheme, they have delegated that responsibility for the day-to-day investment management to them. The pensions contributions are invested in pooled fund, as the member is aware. Can I just stress that the independent fund manager, Bailey Gifford, has a day-to-day responsibility for management decisions, and they operate an environmental, social and governance policy for its investments, and it is also a signatory to the United Nations Principles of Responsible Investing. But just to reinforce, the SPCB's role in relation to this is clearly separated from the Scottish Parliamentary Pensions Act from that of the fund trustees.
Many thanks. Question number two, Patricia Ferguson, please.
To ask the Scottish Parliamentary Corporate Body what consideration it has given to the implications for its employees of the proposals in the UK Government's Trade Union Bill.
John Pentland.
The SPCB is aware of the contents of the bill and officials have begun to assess what systems would have to be amended or put in place should it be passed in the current form. We will continue to monitor developments at Westminster to ensure that we are ready to meet any resultant legal requirements on the Parliament. The corporate body values the strong relationship it has with the trade unions and will continue to work with them in implementing any act resulting from this bill.
Patricia Ferguson.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I have to say I find the answer from the corporate body very disappointing indeed. This bill is regressive in nature and will do nothing to facilitate good working arrangements within this Parliament. I would have hoped that the corporate body might have been willing to take the route that many local authorities now in Scotland are taking and ensure that regardless of what legislation the UK Parliament passes in this regard, that if it isn't amended or has significant changes made to it, that they'd be willing to guarantee that they will continue with issues like check-off and facility time in order to make sure that trade unions in this Parliament are treated in the way that we would all want to be, as partners in negotiation and as worthwhile enterprises in and of themselves.
John Pentland.
I think even though there was overwhelming opposition to the bill on Tuesday, I think it would be inappropriate for the SPCB to take a position on the bill. The corporate body will continue to monitor developments and will, as with any legislation, take such steps as necessary to comply with any legal requirements placed on the Parliament. And as I mentioned in my earlier answer to you, there is a strong relationship with our unions, and we will do everything we can to maintain this positive relationship, regardless of the outcome of that bill.
Briefly, John Wilson.
Officer, if the member and the corporate body are aware, we had a debate in this chamber on Tuesday where an overwhelming majority of members in this chamber voted against the trade union bill, or opposition to the trade union bill. Surely the Scottish corporate body should take that on board when making decisions and policy on behalf of this Parliament.
John Maitland.
Again, Presiding Officer, I would just say at this particular time it's inappropriate for the SPCB to take a position on the bill.
Question number 3, Jean Urquhart.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Parliamentary Corporate Body what criteria it uses when selecting or accepting artwork for display.
Linda Fabiani, please.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Artwork accepted by the Scottish Parliamentary Corporate Body for the Parliament's art collection for display in the building is chosen in line with the art collection development policy. The selection and commissioning of artwork for display is guided by key themes: Scotland's identity and diversity, and the Parliament's relationship with people, the relationship of the people with the land and sea, and of course Scotland's history. We have placed emphasis on acquiring work from artists whose reputation is already well established, and on acquiring works that represent key aspects of their practice.
Thank you, Jean Urquhart.
I thank you for that response. I personally know of people who have sought to donate works of art and have had a negative response, and I can understand that. It is a rare and sensitive thing to select art for such a building. What I don't understand is why the recent work of art, Service, now hanging in the garden lobby, passed any approval test. It gives offence to many, and not only artistically. Scotland has produced fine war artists who might show the awesome bloody beauty of war, what our army does. There are acclaimed artists, masters of art, art critics and art historians here in Edinburgh who might all have advised our Parliament, and we might have seen the army in Scotland reflected as its history truly deserves. Would the Scottish Parliamentary Corporate Body be willing to consult with Scotland's acclaimed and renowned experts with regard to any future artworks?
Linda Fabiani.
Thank you. We do, of course, have a professional art curator, and we do take advice where appropriate. That already happens. And in relation to that recent acquisition of Service by artist David Rowlands, that was gifted to the Scottish Parliament by the Army in Scotland, and, of course, was unveiled in October. We felt it was a unique opportunity to mark the relationship between the Army and Scottish society through the years, especially it being a gift by the Army. It was part of the First World War Centenary commemoration, and the Commission was funded by voluntary donations from Army communities right across Scotland. It was unveiled on the 100th anniversary of the Battle of Loos, and it will tour venues around Scotland during 2016.
Many thanks. Question number 4, Richard Lyle, please.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Parliamentary Corporate Body what its position is on the Scottish Parliamentary Pension Scheme investing a reported £2.1 million in fossil fuels while the Parliament is trying to move towards renewables.
John Pentland.
Under the Scottish Parliamentary Pensions Act 2009, the day-to-day administration, including investment strategy for the Scottish Parliamentary Pension Scheme, is the sole responsibility of the fund trustees. However, I understand that the investment in fossil fuels has decreased significantly from 11.05% in September 2010 to 3.23% in September 2015.
Richard Lyle.
Can I thank the member for that answer? But in light of the recent press reports regarding MSP and Scottish Parliamentary Pension Scheme, regarding what it's been invested in, and on this point, I agree with Mr. Finney. This already has been, has concerns from my constituents, and we can't simply hide behind the fund manager. Can I be assured that discussions will be held with the investment company to clarify what this fund should be and should not be investing in?
John Pentland.
For the fund trustees to direct any investments, they would need to change to a segregated portfolio arrangement, but that would be a decision for the fund trustees, given their statutory position.
Thank you. Question number 5, Jenny Mara, please.
Parliamentary corporate body how it ensures that pupils from deprived areas have equal access to visiting the Parliament.
Liz Smith.
Could I thank the member for her question? The programme of education sessions both in schools and in the Parliament is somewhere in the region of 20,000 to 22,000 pupils each year, and offers a very wide range of online and other curriculum-based resources, and these are all provided free of charge. And I think it's the combination of that outreach service in addition to inward visits programme that provides that great scope both geographically and on a socio-economic basis to allow pupils to take part in parliamentary work. The team undertakes targeted work on activities to support our Parliament Days programme, as well as the specific events like this year's Inspiring Young Women conference at Holyrood, and it helps to ensure a wider range of opportunities available to schools to engage with the Parliament in the best way that suits their needs.
Jenny Mara.
I would thank the member for her answer. I'm sure she'll agree with me that visits to Parliament are particularly important to bring this place alive and bring democracy alive for children. I have a school in one of the most deprived areas in Dundee where a Primary 7 class has been studying the Scottish Parliament and planning to visit. They face a £700 bill for a bus to Parliament, which they simply cannot afford. What data does the SPCB hold and track on how many schools in deprived areas actually get to visit Parliament? After all, Presiding Officer, this Parliament belongs to everyone in Scotland and should be accessible to all children, irrespective of which school they attend.
Liz Smith.
I think the member makes a good point about the accessibility. That's clearly very important for all pupils, wherever they might be. We do have a good tracking system when it comes to which schools are using the Scottish Parliament. I think the corporate body is very open to suggestions about how, at any stage, we could improve that. We're not in a position to provide funding for travel. There are two other members who have raised this in the past, and that's a difficult situation for the SPCB to attend to. But any suggestions that the member might like to make, we will take them on board.
Many thanks. Question number 6, John Wilson, please.
Officer, to ask the Scottish Parliamentary Corporate Body what action it is taking to improve the speed of server access from members' regional offices.
John Pentland.
The speed of the broadband services available to regional offices is dependent on the public communications infrastructure and varies from location to location. The corporate body ensures that local offices benefit from the best broadband service available to the office and have been piloting solutions that are independent of the public infrastructure to help address a situation where the public broadband infrastructure is not of a sufficient quality. In addition, we have rolled out our new software and supporting hardware to optimise the traffic from all regional offices to Holyrood servers to improve performance and furthermore increase capacity of the internet connection to Holyrood on which services are routed. And we are looking forward to working within the context of the new voice and data contract for fresh and innovative ideas to address the ongoing challenge.
John Wilson.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I appreciate the response from the corporate body, and particularly a renowned expert on IT as Mr Pentland, as he declared on Monday night in Motherwell. Despite the fact internet connection speeds in the regional office are excellent, 50 megabyte speeds is almost akin to super-fast broadband, and the performance of the two PCs is excellent. When logged into the Parliament servers through the Citrix online plugin, there are speed and performance issues with using many of the programmes. This leads to staff being forced to work outside of the Citrix environment, which can then lead to safe conflicts in the shared folders. CPU usage often shoots up and causes severe system lag, particularly when attempting to use Outlook search facilities. I hope the corporate body could investigate this matter and report accordingly, and we can all get super fast speeds in all our regional offices throughout Scotland.
John Pentland.
Presiding Officer, I'm sure we are all aware of individual offices struggle with poor connection speeds, and that's why the business IT will work with the individual offices to look at the different ways that they would work to see if any streamlining can be achieved by changing the methods of connecting back to the service at Holyrood. and this could involve visiting these offices to advise on techniques that may help alleviate or address these issues. And could I just say to the member that his very detailed question, I will make sure he gets a very, very detailed answer from the officers.
Many thanks. Very briefly, Alex Johnson.
I was just going to ask the Deputy Presiding Officer if any consideration is being given to alternative software strategies, because the direct connection using the Citrix connection relies on the system being open all the time. Using appropriate software strategies, we can escape that and we can escape many of the problems of the connections.
John Pentland, please.
Well, again, it's a very, very detailed question, and I will get the officer to give you a detailed response.
Thank you. Question number 7, Patrick Harvey.
Thank you. Can I ask the corporate body what action it takes to address staff welfare issues related to winter weather?
John Pentland.
The SPCB provides a number of initiatives to address staff welfare during the winter months, including flu vaccinations and support for individuals with health conditions exacerbated by winter weather. In circumstances where the staff are unable to attend work due to transport disruption as a result of the severe weather, flexible working arrangements such as home working or reduced hours may be offered on a short-term basis.
Patrick Harvey.
I've never quite understood why one of our security staff has to be stationed halfway up the corridor to the chamber all the time when we're in session. But that corridor is probably the coldest part of the building, and over the next few months it's going to be a very, very uncomfortable place for them to stand with little to do. I know they've been given permission to have a small electric heater with them now, but could I ask the corporate body if it could reassess whether there's actually a need for security staff to stand there in that empty corridor all day, and if there is, can they at least be allowed to put a coat on?
John Pentland.
I take on board the question raised by the member, and I will make sure we come back to put a relevant answer.
Many thanks. That concludes questions to the Scottish Parliamentary Corporate Body. And we will now turn to the next item of business, which is a debate on motion number 14560 in the name of Hugh Henry on the future delivery of social security in Scotland. Can I invite those members who would like to be considered to speak in this debate to press the request to speak buttons now, please, and to call on Hugh Henry to speak to and to move the motion on behalf of the Welfare Reform Committee. Mr Henry, 8 minutes or so.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and I move the motion submitted in my name. This is an unusual debate. We don't have a committee report to bring to Parliament for you to consider, to comment on and to debate. In a sense, we're actually looking for your ideas, because we do face one of the biggest challenges that this Parliament and the Scottish Government has had to face since the creation of the Parliament in 1999. Effectively, not only are we going to have to make decisions about taxation, but we will have to set up a new system of social security and welfare, and that will it will certainly cause problems, but also I think it gives us opportunities. So we do genuinely want to hear what members have to say. We've decided to use the term social security rather than welfare because, to some extent, the term welfare over the years has become a somewhat abused and tarnished one. What we are not doing in the committee, and we will have a report relatively soon, but we are not examining whether the Smith Commission proposals are a cohesive and sensible set of powers. That's not what we've been asked to do. We're not examining whether the powers that are there in the bill actually reflect what the Smith Commission intended, nor are we arguing about what the Smith Commission should have said and what the bill should have said. And many of the other matters have been effectively dealt with by the Devolution Further Powers Committee, and I'll leave them to take that forward. What we are looking at is how the powers that are in the bill should best be used, and that's where we're looking for ideas. I think it's important in something as significant as a new social security system that we do have consensus, if that is at all possible. I realise that there will be arguments within the political parties about different aspects of benefits and what is or is not permissible. But I do hope that there could be certain fundamental principles that we can have agreement on. We want to try to have a social security system that not only will achieve some consensus, but in establishing that, will give it a degree of consistency so that it's not at the political whim at each election looking at fundamental changes. Now, we've heard from a range of organisations and contributors to the committee, and there are certain themes that come up time and time again. The words dignity and respect have been used, and I think that there is a burning desire to have those aspects at the heart of any system. We have heard that people want a person-centred system. There is huge frustration about bureaucracy and the fact that people often feel that they are treated as numbers rather than human beings. There is a desire to have a system that's based on personal and human rights, and there is a huge demand to have, where possible, passporting so that people don't have to make a multiplicity of claims at different stages in the system. And last but not least, one of the things that we have heard is that people want the claims system to be simple. Try to use ordinary language that ordinary people can understand and avoid the legalese and the language of the bureaucracy. You know, if there are other issues that people can identify, then please let us know. We've looked at, certainly.
John Wilson.
The comment there from Mr. Henry about the making the language simpler. Would it also be useful to make the form filling easier? Because some of the benefits at the present moment can be up to 32 pages long to actually fill in and make a claim. So would the committee be looking at the form filling as well as the legalese that is often used in terms of the application process?
Well, that is very much what we mean by making the process simpler. Some of those examples have been mentioned to the committee. And yes, where at all possible, we want the forms to be relatively short, straightforward, simple, easy to understand. On the issues of disability living allowance and personal independence payments, which we will inherit, it's a huge scheme, huge responsibility. Currently a budget of £1.5 billion a year affecting hundreds of thousands of people. How should that be run in the future? Now, I met yesterday with Rosanna Cunningham and Alex Neil, and I know that in each of their respective areas of responsibility, they're struggling to come up with specific ideas which they will hopefully bring forward to this Parliament relatively soon. There are huge challenges there, but as far as disability living allowance and PIP is concerned, you know, what should the eligibility criteria be? On carers allowance, and this is something which does cause a lot of anguish and anger. Carers often feel that they're at the fag end of the process, that people don't look at them, that the carers allowance doesn't properly reflect the input that carers have. What should the definition of carers would be? Should we change that, and how should we operate that carers allowance? Because carers, and I think we've heard time and time again in this Parliament, just how much carers contribute through unpaid activity and effort. One of the biggest areas of contention, I think, is likely to be the work programme and work choice. We've heard a lot of contentious evidence from people who feel that the work programme has let them down, that they don't feel that they've been given due respect, that they don't feel that they've been given proper support. And I'm not here to defend the providers of that programme, but to some extent, they are there to deliver something that was set up and the constraints established by the Department of Work and Pensions. So we will need to look at what criteria we want to establish for the delivery of that. And, you know, we need to look at whether we're going to have a simple replacement, whether we'll have a national scheme, or whether, you know, has there been some suggestions whether there should be regional variations to reflect local labour markets in different areas. Now, one particular area of contention in relation to the work programme was that relating to people with disabilities. And people with disabilities felt that they were being forced into a process where there was no real intention to actually help them into work, but the people the bureaucracy concerned was simply trying to tick a box to show that they were trying to make people look for work. And I think we do need to reflect on how we treat people, not just with disabilities, but with significant long-term illnesses and mental health problems. Presiding Officer, I'm aware of the time, so I will... Do I have time?
Yes, I can give you time.
Okay, thank you. So what should replace the work programme? I know that Scottish Government has been in consultation with the private and voluntary sector, and they're interested to hear ideas about what any future scheme should look at. And we're talking about huge contracts, £100 million per year. Should it be delivered by private organisations? Should we be looking at a consortia of charities and voluntary organisations, either on a national or on a regional basis? And what about work choice that we often ignore in relation to people with disabilities? And I mentioned that as well. Regulated social fund covers a relatively small area of activity, but there were some areas of concern raised. Funeral payments, and one of the biggest problems that came up about funeral payments was actually the cost of funerals. And that isn't necessarily something that we would have locus for in our committee, but there is a huge financial burden on families who are having to cope with a bereavement. And how should any future funeral payment scheme operate? Other issues, cold weather payments and winter fuel payments, two different schemes operating in different ways. Should the schemes be universal? Should they be merged? How should they work? And should people who no longer live in Scotland necessarily be entitled to any of those payments in the future? Universal credit is one for the future, but it will incorporate seven current benefits. We won't be in control of that, but there will be important powers in relation to the administration of that. Some issues will be housing benefit, and I was pleased to hear from the Minister, the Cabinet Secretaries, that housing benefit can and will be paid where required to the landlord. I think that's progress, and perhaps the Minister will confirm that today. Should it be paid fortnightly rather than monthly? And could it be paid to more than one householder where necessary? Again, we would seek your views on that. Top-up benefits, and that's been a contentious issue in the last week or two in relation to tax credits, but we will have the ability to top up devolved benefits, but of course that then requires us to find the money to do that, and that will cause and create a challenge for this Parliament and for the Scottish Government. Are there particular groups that we should be looking at beyond those in receipt of tax credits? How will we use our budget to look at who we would help and in what circumstances? And finally, in conclusion, Presiding Officer, delivery, which is going to be the key issue. Do we have a national system? Do we have local systems? Do we have a national system and local delivery? Who should be the local delivery agents? Again, we've heard some conflicting views, some suspicion of some of the local agencies that are there, and an aspiration to avoid a postcode lottery. But equally, people do want consistency, but they want a more personalised decision-making process that may well require some local input. So how do we help people through the system from a Westminster-based one to a Scottish-based one? There is undoubtedly people who could be affected as a result. We need to look at transition systems. And again, we don't have a final view, but we would welcome any comments on that. So, Presiding Officer, those are just some of the issues that we've been looking at, some of the issues that the Scottish Government is having to contend with, and we do have an opportunity, all of us here, to help create something that is entirely new and hopefully will work well for the benefit of the people that we represent. Thank you.
Thank you, Convener. I now call on Margaret Burgess, Minister, 10 minutes or so.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. And I welcome this opportunity to take part in this debate because I do think it is an important debate. And at the start, I would just like to thank the Welfare Reform Committee both for today's motion and for the work they've taken forward over the past few years. The Scottish Government is pleased to work with the committee and hope we can continue to do so in the journey ahead. And I also want to make it clear to the Chamber that this Scottish Government will always use the powers we have to protect and benefit the people of Scotland. We are also very clear about ensuring that the necessary financial arrangements are in place, as well as the mechanisms to deliver new powers. As we all know, the UK Government's ideologically driven programme of welfare reform has been near the top of the political agenda and news in Scotland for the large parts of the last 5 years, and with good reason. We strongly support the committee's endorsement of the House of Commons Work and Pensions Committee call for a full and independent review of the sanctions system. We also welcome recommendations that the UK Government publish a tracking study to examine the cost of sanctions, revise the sanctions appeals process, and allow more discretion for DWP staff in dealing with vulnerable claimants at risk of being sanctioned. And many other recommendations have been made to the UK Government, and we fully support the spirit and content of these. It remains our ambition to develop a distinctly Scottish approach to powers over social security, as promised by the Smith Commission and through the Scotland Bill. To develop that approach, we are listening carefully to the views of people receiving the benefits that are being devolved and to the organisations that support and represent them. And I know the committee has also worked closely with many of these people and organisations. And those organisations will be pleased that the Welfare Reform Committee is now taking the issue of delivery of social security to the floor of the chamber today and that their views are being heard. And I welcome that the committee is looking to hear from members about the principles and practicalities that we will want to see from a new social security system. We, like many others, remain committed to developing a Scottish approach to social security, which has at its heart a set of principles and values. Our vision is of an approach which is person-centred, and Hugh Henry referred to that, which treats people with dignity and respect. And we look forward to working cooperatively with the committee and other stakeholders in holding a united front against austerity measures and working together to bring the new social security powers successfully to this Parliament. We'll continue to work closely with COSLA, the NHS and others across Civic Scotland to understand the links between the benefits being devolved and existing services, because we know that we can't deliver our aspirations on our own. We need to take others with us, and it has to be a joint approach. The Parliament will be well aware that we recently published an update paper on what we've learned from our engagement, and this was a valuable exercise for us and demonstrates our commitment to listening to those people who will be directly affected by the new powers. And it's worth reflecting on what we've heard, as this chimes with evidence heard by the Welfare Reform Committee. And disability, we've heard about the problems, and Hugh Henry mentioned them as well, caused by the delays in the assessment and decision process for the new personal independence payment and the impact this is having on vulnerable people. So we are working with stakeholders to look at how assessments can be improved. And again, I think in response to John Wilson raised a question about a simplified system. I think we all want to see a system that's simpler, that people can understand, and that's in a language also that they can understand, and that to access it, any applications, I will give way.
John Wilson.
Thank the Minister for giving way. I know you've taken on board the point about making the system simpler, but many of the constituents that I come across that have benefit difficulties also have literacy issues. And how do we get round the fact that some of the forms and the way that's presented, doesn't matter how simple you make it, because of the literacy problems, they still have problems filling these forms in?
Minister? I think the member makes a very good point, and that's something that we're looking at and discussing with stakeholders. It's about the help and support and assistance we give to people who perhaps are unable to fill in a form on their own. And as the member said, no matter how easy the form is, it can be difficult for some people. So we have to ensure that the system, a social security system, is accessible and that the right support's in place for people to ensure that they can access the benefits to which they're entitled. And I think we've also shown in our approach, we're working how we can improve things, how we want to take a fair approach by, for example, abolishing the 84-day rule that penalises families of severely disabled children by removing DLA and carers' allowance if their children are hospitalised for lengthy periods of time. We've heard from a number of parties on the issues carers face, and the First Minister's recent comments about beginning to raise carers' allowance to the same rate as job seekers' allowance reflects the importance of the role carers play on behalf of society in taking care of the people who need them and rely on them. So we've made it clear we'll use the flexibilities, again referred to by Hugh Henry, on universal credit that the Scotland Bill allows us to provide an opportunity to deliver a service which is more suited to the particular needs of Scotland. And this includes the frequency of payments to those making claims and the payment of the housing costs element direct to social landlords, and we've already given our commitment on that. Importantly, we'll also effectively abolish the hated and pernicious bedroom tax. As we've heard this morning in the papers and seen in the papers, there are areas of Scotland where this has hit badly. And the government, this government is proud of fully mitigating the bedroom tax and investing £90 million to do so. For the work programme and work choice, there have been over 200 responses to the consultation. It's clear that the work programme is not working for those most in need. In developing and implementing devolved employment support services from 2017, we intend to focus on those who are not well supported in the current DWP programmes, and the Cabinet Secretary for Fair Work will respond to the consultation shortly and make clear the ambitions and the direction of travel for delivery by 2017. I would, of course, have preferred that we were receiving powers over all employment support programmes, because I see no reason why we have to wait 12 months before stepping in to help someone who's unemployed. And this is an example of the qualifications and constraints that are imposed on the social security provisions of the bill, including those on benefit sanctions. On the regulated social fund, we've heard a range of views on what should be done when those powers are devolved. And the Cabinet Secretary has recently commissioned a report to look at ways of relieving the financial burden and debt that bereaved relatives and families face when organising a funeral. And we've asked them to come up with a series of recommendations to address the rising cost of funerals. And this will inform the work being carried out and how funeral payments can be delivered in a better way, because, again, it's clear the current system is not working. And we're pleased, as the Scotland Bill goes forward, that discussions between the UK Government and Scottish Government have borne some fruit. The UK Government has admitted that the bill as introduced didn't deliver on the recommendations of the Smith Commission, which the Scottish Government has been saying for over a year. The bill now contains a power to create new benefits, which we welcome, as this is something we've pushed for some time. Devolving existing powers with funding that goes to resource them that we already pay for through our taxation would always have been a better solution. Instead, we are left with a sticking plaster approach to alleviate the Tory cuts. However, Presiding Officer, I'll take a brief intervention.
I'm Mel Goldie.
Grateful to the Minister. It's not in any specific part of what she's been saying, but it's a general shape of what I think Mr Henry was alluding to. We are going to be responsible for about £2.7 billion worth of welfare expenditure in Scotland. Does the Minister envisage some kind of shape for delivery, like a responsible Minister for Welfare and a department to deal with that, and has there been any thought given by the Scottish Government about what does come from a national level and what might be better delivered at local level?
Minister?
I mean, I think these are the very points that we're currently deliberating on and consulting on, and the Cabinet Secretary said that in the next parliamentary term he will introduce a social security bill, so it might answer some of the questions the member has. But I would just say, when talking about social security, Hugh Henry in his opening speech said the committee preferred the term social security to welfare. And I also prefer that term. In actual fact, I might be the first and last minister with welfare in their title. But I do think the common perception of welfare is not a fitting description of what people in receipt of benefits are experiencing. We want an approach to social security that supports people and treats those who are entitled to benefits with fairness and dignity. And I know that much of Civic Scotland and across this chamber feel the same. And members may be aware that the Scottish Government has used the term social security for some time now. In the recently published stocktake paper that I mentioned earlier, we specifically highlight that the powers we are receiving are over social security rather than welfare. Presiding Officer, let me conclude by saying that we value the work the committee has done and appreciate the time and effort so many stakeholders have put into providing both the committee and the government with information, and how ideas on how we want to see a social security system delivered in Scotland. We are pleased that the issues coming through the committee's inquiry are similar to those being picked up by the Scottish Government in our consultations, and I'm looking forward to hearing the members' contributions later.
Many thanks, Minister. I now call on Alec Rowley. 7 minutes or so, please.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I will also welcome this debate. As Hugh Henry said in his introduction, that it's a bit unusual that there is no report as such, and we're being asked for a debate in terms of what our views are. My view is, and it's perhaps to a point that Annabel Goldie raised just now in terms of about what is the shape. I believe that we need to have an anti-poverty strategy in Scotland, and these powers that we will have, which are significant, need to be used as part of that strategy and joined up with a whole range of policies. And what we need to see that often I believe is lacking, certainly at a UK level but also at a Scottish level, is joined up government with clear objectives, and a clear objective for Scotland has got to be to tackle poverty. There's a family centre that I have been a supporter of for many years in Kirkcaldy, the Cottage Family Centre. In 2012, that family centre delivered 100 food hampers for needy children. Last year, the figure was 500. This year, it's expected to be over 800. Last year, they gave out 90 children for warm coats for the winter. This year, they have already received over 250 requests. In 24% of the population are deemed to be in poverty. And in some of the poorest communities, it's as much as 36%. That's not just a picture of Fife, that's a picture of communities across Scotland, and our objective has to be to how are we going to tackle that. It's also interesting, I came across a YouGov poll which found that on average people thought that 40% of the welfare state budget goes to the registered unemployed. That of course is a myth. It is only 1.5%. and 8% if we include disabled and single parents who stay at home with their children. But an astonishing 2/3 of British children grown up in poverty live in a family where at least one adult works. Indeed, 59% of those children in Scotland are in working families where the main breadwinner works all hours that he or she can. So it's a complete myth to suggest that the majority of poor children grow up in families lacking a desire to work, when the hard evidence is that they would work far more hours and even more hours if they were able to do so. And that's why we need to ensure that these joined-up policies that we create also focus on how we can actually support people to be in work. very often where people come off benefits to go into work, such as at this time of the year, where even though they're not the best jobs going, there'll be jobs in my constituency, in Amazon, for example, it totally mucks up their benefits, and then they find themselves in a difficult situation trying to get back onto benefits. So we need to address those issues as we move forward. I think also the point that Hugh Henry and the Minister made in terms of there is an opportunity here to engage and involve organisation, groups and indeed individuals right across Scotland in terms of what this new social security system should look like. One such group is Enable Scotland, who amongst a number of organisations have sent briefings in, and I know have been talking to the committee, but they say there is key opportunities as we move forward. Key opportunities, the ability to amend the criteria to ensure that the main working age disability benefit is fit for purpose, the ability to improve the claim and decision-making processes for disabled benefits to improve accuracy of decision-making, reducing administrative and assessment costs and ensuring that claimants are treated with respect at all stages of the process. And while John Wilson talks about making it easier to fill in forms, etc., that question of being treated with respect, of being supported. And again, we should have joined up working at every level involving local government. How do we support people who are making claims, who are often for the first time, and find the whole thing to be very difficult? The ability to remove the suspension of payability of disabled benefits when claimants have been in hospital for 28 days. So there are a lot of ideas and a lot of views out there that we need to take on board as we move forward. They do, however, talk about some of the challenges, and they do say the full details of the fiscal framework for further devolution are not yet known. The finer details of this will have a significant impact on the ability to use any of these powers. I would say to the Minister, and I think it's an important point that she needs to reflect back to the Government, there seems to be private discussions, secret discussions that are going on between Mr Mundell and Mr Swinney in terms of the fiscal framework. I think it's important that we have more transparency around those discussions. Yep.
Mark MacDonald.
Member for giving way. Of course, at the recent Finance Committee debate on the fiscal framework, Mr Swinney said explicitly to representatives of the Labour Party, the Conservatives and the Liberal Democrats that he was more than happy to receive correspondence from them outlining the areas of the fiscal framework discussions they wish to learn more about. Can Mr Rowley confirm if the Labour Party have corresponded with Mr Swinney to that effect?
Alec Rowley.
Well, I've certainly met with Mr Swinney and made that exact point to him, that it's difficult to actually comment on something that you're not sure. We have Mr Swinney on the one hand saying that it's not a good deal for Scotland. None of us in this chamber would want to sign up to a bad deal for Scotland, I assume. None of us would sign up to a pig in the poke. But if the discussions remain private and confidential and in secret between Mr Swinney and Mr Mundell, then it's very difficult to comment. And I've certainly made that point to him. I want to make some progress. I also want to make the point in terms of in-work poverty. There is a new power in Scotland. You know, in the 21st century, young people in their 20s, including young couples whose income from work is low, stagnating when their rents and living costs are so high, and who fall into the poverty gap. 30% of working men in their 20s and 35% of working women in their 20s earn less than the living wage. And I would draw attention to a pamphlet that has been circulated for Jane Baxter, MSP, making the case for the living wage. This Parliament has powers to be able to do more around the living wage, and we should certainly be looking at what progress we can make. I welcome those companies that are announcing that they want to be living wage employers. But within the public sector, if you take the care sector, for example, where there is a mass of people, 80% of the care sector is in the private sector, and the majority of them are working for the minimum wage, we need to address that. Alongside that, we need to address the attacks coming from a Tory Chancellor on tax credits, which will drive more and more families in Scotland into poverty. And we need to unite in this chamber, yes,
to fight those tax cuts, but also to say that if those tax cuts were to go ahead, if those tax cuts, if those tax cuts were to go ahead, then we would unite and use the resources coming and the powers coming to this Parliament to actually ensure that no one suffers and no one is worse off as a result of tax credits. Can I also very quickly, Presiding Officer, the work programme. We need to recognise that in Scotland there are many people who are far removed from the labour market. And the best way to provide the support at a local level is through local government and local government organising. The work programme needs to be devolved, and if it is devolved, we can be more effective. But my main point would be we need joined-up government, a joined-up approach and an all-out attack on poverty and inequality in Scotland.
Thank you. Now calling Alex Johnston. 7 minutes or so, please, Mr Johnston.
Thank you very much, Deputy Presiding Officer. This is a debate I'm very glad to be able to become involved in. It's on a subject which many of us have been involved in some very heated discussions of late and over recent years. But I welcome the tone in which this debate has been introduced. And I think, hopefully, we might at the end of this afternoon have a more constructive outcome than we've experienced at some previous debates. When I say about welcoming the tone, I acknowledge the remarks that were made by the convener of the committee at the outset about the terms we use to cover the subjects that we're discussing. I think this is a huge opportunity for us because, of course, language costs nothing. But if we get the language right, it can achieve so much. And if we can gather around a change in the language, a change in the terms we use, we can perhaps begin the process of building back into the system the respect which, unfortunately, research indicates has dropped out of it so often. The great challenge we have when we're talking about the future delivery of welfare or social security, should I say, better get that right, is that we don't have a great deal of time on our side. The likelihood is that we may be in a position to begin introducing these measures that are available to us under the new powers as early as May 2017. That means that we're going into an election next year, May 2016, at which we will have had to discuss policy and its implementation. So we're right up against a deadline to start talking about how we'll deliver these new powers. But many of the lessons about how these new powers will be delivered come from the experience we've already had. And there have been one or two aspects of welfare which have been devolved in recent years and give us something to look at. Particularly the Scottish Welfare Fund, which is delivered now in terms of crisis grants and community care grants. That was perhaps devolved at rather short notice, came as a surprise to many when it was passed to local authorities in England and became the responsibility of the Scottish Government here in Scotland. The decision was made to pass that on to local authorities. And we had an opportunity with the interim scheme to look at how that worked and then brought in a final scheme that delivered that more effectively, in my view. But the two things that taught us is, firstly, there is something to be said for doing things differently in different areas. And whether it's the delivery of benefits in cash or kind, or whether it's the opportunity to do so in person or over the internet, different local authorities found different ways of achieving that. And I think that difference and the fact that success was achieved in different ways in different areas is one lesson for the future. Secondly, by the time the scheme was properly up and running and the funding levels had, or demand levels had stabilised, it became clear that local authorities were an effective way to deliver. The problem was, of course, that because of the size of the scheme and the staff required in local authority areas, that too much of the money made available through the scheme was going in administration. And the lesson there is that if they can do it effectively, but inefficiently in cash terms, one of the ways to recover that resource is to give them more to do so that the staff involved can actually operate more efficiently to get that money out. But essentially, what we need are systems to provide support which are easy to use, easy to understand, as the Minister said in her opening remarks, but also predictable and familiar. Because the final lesson we got from the devolution of the Scottish Welfare Fund was that many people who had previously relied upon it believed it had simply been abolished and were unaware that the fund was still available in a different form. And that's one of the reasons why uptake was so poor in the first year. When we get to the major changes, the change to universal credit and personal independence payments, these are already controversial. They are part of the welfare reform programme that has been driven from the South and has been attacked for many reasons, not least the political ones. But these will form the foundations of the welfare system that we will go ahead and build upon here in Scotland. I am delighted that changes have been made that will allow certain flexibilities in universal credit. If we in Scotland feel it's more appropriate to pay more frequently than once a month, if we feel it's more appropriate for us to pay housing benefit directly to a landlord, then we should be able to take up that opportunity. However, on direct payment to landlords, while I think it's vital that we do have that power and use it where it's required, I don't believe it should simply be a system that has been abused as it has been in the past. Those who can manage their own affairs and have demonstrated that should be allowed to do so. When it comes to tax credits, they've sort of risen to the top of the agenda in recent weeks. It is clear from statements that have been made by David Mundell that the opportunity exists under the systems devolved by the New Scotland Bill, that the opportunity to top up will be there. There are certain difficulties about topping up benefits where entitlement doesn't exist, but I believe that these problems can be dealt with through the discussions that are currently taking place around the fiscal framework. That challenge, no thank you, that challenge is one that the ministers of both governments will have to rise to, but certainly the Secretary of State for Scotland is keen to find a solution to that problem. Also, on the subject of carers' allowance being uprated to match job seekers' allowance, I believe that it's one area where Ruth Davidson managed to get in just ahead of the Minister and commit the Conservatives to that policy before it was announced at the SNP conference. The challenges we face are many. We are, on this side of the chamber, closely related to the government that is driving part of this agenda from the South. But we also believe that it's right to devolve the powers that are being devolved, and we want to see them used effectively. The big challenge, however, is to get to the bottom line and say, if this government is committed to increasing spend, we do need to know where that money will be coming from.
Thank you. We now turn to the open debate. Speeches of 6 minutes or so, please. Could members check that they have pressed the request to speak buttons if they wish to participate? I call Kevin Stewart, to be followed by Malcolm Chisholm.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The Tory social security reforms are wreaking havoc for many of our most vulnerable people. And during my time in the Welfare Reform Committee, we've heard stories from affected people that have frustrated and angered me. And during a recent session, looking at the work programme, we heard from Diane, who said, "The biggest thing for me about the work programme has been the advisers. The first one I had was terrible. I had 3 meetings with him and he'd made me greet twice. He was mean and a bit of a bully. It's bad because all this takes place in an open plan office so everyone can see you greeting. Throughout the whole of my engagement with the work programme, I've lived in fear of sanctions. This has also not been helpful to my health." People are certainly not being treated with dignity and respect that they deserve. And in my opinion, that's just not good enough. I was pleased that when we passed the Scottish Welfare Fund legislation, this Parliament accepted an amendment that I lodged on dignity and respect. And I hope that we build this into every single piece of social security legislation that this Parliament deals with in future. We'll soon have competence over the work programme, and we must ensure that we follow the respect agenda in everything that we do. However, it is galling that Westminster will retain powers over sanctions, which may blow a hole in our ability to ensure that folk are treated fairly and respectfully. It would have been so much better if all aspects of conditionality had been devolved too, and many organisations share my view on this point. Tanya Gilchrist of the Shaw Trust said, I certainly think that it will cause confusion. We are talking about people who are already dissatisfied with the current service delivery. If we have reserved and devolved rules potentially affecting such people, that could ultimately cause confusion and more dissatisfaction. And Kate Still of Employment Support Scotland said, we advocated the devolution to Scotland of Job Centre Plus and all the related levers because we think that it would work better. Even with these fetters, we must ensure that our work programme takes full consideration of individuals and what their circumstances actually are. I'd also like to say that it is galling that the Access to Work programme, which helps disabled people get the equipment that they need to get into work, has not been devolved. And I don't understand the logic of that particular decision, but let's be honest with you, many of the decisions that have been taken round about what to and what not to devolve defy logic. Now, we've heard today from the Labour benches and from Mr Johnson not minutes ago about tax credits. What we've seen this week in the House of Commons was an SNP amendment to the Scotland Bill which sought to devolve all powers over tax credits, which if passed would have meant the powers over all aspects and all resources transferring to this place was defeated. It was defeated by 477 votes to 56, a majority of 421. The Labour Party chose to go through the lobbies with the Conservatives to allow them to retain the powers over tax credits. It's not at the moment. It seems that the Labour Party are willing to mitigate, or want us to mitigate, over tax credits, but are unwilling for this Parliament to take control over the powers. I have to say that is somewhat bizarre, presiding officer, but I will maybe give Mr MacDonald the opportunity to tell us why the Labour Party took the bizarre decision to walk through the lobbies with the Tories on Monday.
Lewis MacDonald.
I'm very grateful to Mr Stewart. Does he believe that this Parliament should use the powers that we will have to mitigate fully against the impact of cuts to tax credits?
The answer to the question is that I believe that this Parliament should use all of the powers at its disposal. Now, one of the things which the Labour Party seem to think is we'll be able to mitigate the tax credit situation, but they've not taken account of the difficulties that there may be there. And a quote from Professor Alan Trench of the Institute for Public Policy Research, who appeared in front of the Welfare Committee this week. He said, I would take the view that legally there is a power within the framework of the bill to top up tax credits. But the practical difficulties, which Professor Spicker and David Iser started to elaborate, seem to me to make it hugely difficult, if not utterly impossible, to accomplish that. David Iser, the research fellow from the University of Stirling, who appeared the same day, said, it's worth saying, first of all, of course, that there is a
timing issue, and that the tax credits
will start to happen before these powers come to Scotland anyway. It's not clear to me at the moment, from the way the legislation is set out, to what extent the Scottish Government will be able to top up these eligible rates with the work allowance and the taper still being reserved. I'll take you in a little while, Ms Goldie, if you just wait, because I want to finish this point. It would have been far easier for the Labour Party to abandon their better together friends in the Tories and actually have gone through the lobbies with us to try and get these powers devolved to this place, instead of us having to face these problems and whether or not we can mitigate. And I'll take Baroness Goldie, because she can maybe tell us why she voted for tax credit cuts in the House of Lords.
I thank Mr Stewart for giving way. Does he accept that the bill, the Scotland bill, will allow topping up of existing benefits, creation of new benefits in all areas of devolved competence, and of course the flexibility of using the income tax bands, which a Minister for Finance and the Scottish Government can use to apply a nil band or a reduced band if that's what the Minister wants to do? And how would Mr Stewart deploy these measures to address the issue which he's identifying?
Kevin Stewart.
That was a speech rather than an intervention, I would say, Presiding Officer. But I think that Baroness Goldie needs to go and have a look at what was said at the Welfare Committee this week. Because Professor Paul Spicker said, in political terms and economic terms, it may be exceedingly difficult for Scotland to vary the terms in which benefits are delivered. Some folks seem to think that the powers that we are getting are the panacea to almost everything. That is not the case, and the hole in all of that was blown this week by these academics that appeared in front of the Welfare Reform Committee. And, you know, the hole has also been punched through by many others who are very, very wary about what is about to happen. And we're discussing all of this today, Presiding Officer, without even knowing what the resource background to all of this is going to be. Because, as has already been pointed out, the fiscal framework has not been agreed. So we may be being sold a pig in a poke here. That is the reality of all of this. So even if we wanted to top up and we wanted to mitigate, there are barriers there. And beyond that, there are going to be resource barriers as well, which were pointed out by Mr Iser at the Welfare Reform Committee Tuesday too. And I'll take Mr Rowley if I've got time, Presiding
Officer. Mr Stewart, you're well over time. It would need to be extremely short, Mr Rowley.
That's what you said about the bedroom tax. You said we couldn't mitigate the bedroom tax. 2 weeks ago you said we couldn't use these powers to get to mitigate the tax credits, and now we are. But would you agree that we need transparency around the fiscal framework?
Kevin Stewart,
what I would say is we had difficulties in mitigating the bedroom tax and had to get additional powers to do so. How easy is it going to be to get additional powers to deal with some of the flaws that seem to be in this bill? In terms of the fiscal framework, there's currently an intergovernmental negotiation going on. You and others have been told by Mr Swinney that you can talk to him about any aspects. I'm quite sure that he will listen to anyone who has any view on how we can get the best possible deal for Scotland out of that agreement. However, I have to say that I'm utterly sceptical, and it would have been best if we had those powers.
Thank you. Before we move on, can I remind the Chamber to speak through the Chair, please? And also, if members wish to make interventions, can they ensure that their microphones are facing the right direction? Thank you. Malcolm Chisholm, to be followed by Christina McGill.
I did think that we had a settled, albeit inadequate, position on the bedroom tax from the First Minister at First Minister's questions last week, but we now have, I think, what must be about the 10th position of the SNP on tax credits in the last 10 days. But I really think this debate should not be dominated by that, because we know that debate will continue for many months to come. In general terms, I welcome the fact that over £2.5 billion of social security responsibility will be coming to Scotland. And while I may have wanted a bit more personally to come to Scotland, I think everybody will recognise that the Smith recommendations on social security and indeed on other matters have now been substantially delivered. And of course the main changes this week, and we have to give credit to the UK government for the changes they made on Monday, but the main ones being the introduction of new devolved benefits, the top up, the ability to top up reserve benefits, and also other changes which I won't list all of them, but for example the removal of the restrictive definition in relation to carers allowance. So I think all that in fact has been welcomed by most members of the SNP in other contexts. Of course, there was some disappointment, and there's still the House of Lords to come, so we can be looking to Baroness Goldie if we wish further changes. I think there was some disappointment that the restriction of the definition in relation to disability allowance was not changed, so there is still some scope for that, and also that there was no amendments to the employment provisions. So although the administration of employment programmes are devolved, there are still some problems around, for example, access and the interrelationship with the sanctions regime. Now, as the convener, Hugh Henry, said at the beginning, the committee heard from a range of organisations, and I was pleased to read some of those representations. I couldn't read them all because there were such a large number of organisations clearly interested in this subject, and Hugh Henry outlined and summarised some of the key principles that came forward in those submissions. For example, that we need a system based on personal and human rights, that there should be passporting rather than a multiplicity of claims, that the system should be simple, and crucially, that there should be dignity and respect at the heart of a person-centred system. I was interested, in fact, in relation to that, to see a comment from the Poverty Alliance, who actually said that dignity and choice are closely related. And they said that, and this was critical of something the Scottish Government have done already, they said, and I quote, "We have seen this in the delivery of the Scottish Welfare Fund, with people feeling that they have been stigmatised by the lack of choice in how grants are awarded." And that, of course, refers to the vouchers being given rather than cash. Shelter also were enthusiastic about the principles. I don't think I've got time to quote them, but they felt that there were great opportunities to embed principles of dignity, respect and so on in Scotland's housing system. And, of course, that will be reflected, hopefully, very soon after the powers are acquired by the abolition of the benefit tax. But there were lots of, I thought, specific positive suggestions from different organisations, even those who wanted more powers. For example, Sam H wanted the Access to Work programme to be devolved as part of the employment programmes, but they also made the interesting point that more individuals with mental health problems should be referred to the Work Choice programme, which will be devolved, pointing out that that would allow a greater number of people with disabilities to access the specialist support they require. And the whole issue of disability, of course, featured prominently in the submission, since the substantial powers over disability benefits are being devolved. I thought One Parent Families Scotland made an interesting point that the control over disability benefits should be at a national rather than a local level, and they were concerned about the erosion of entitlement, among other matters. So that's one interesting issue that we will have to debate subsequently. I think sometimes it's better that something should be local, but they're arguing for national national administration of that. Inclusion Scotland were interesting and as ever, and of course some of their demands do involve extra money, and that's one thing we'll have to consider, but many of their suggestions also are not related to more money. For example, they say that staff administering new disability benefits should have customer-focused disability equality training, that face-to-face assessments should be become less common, and that, in fact, the benefits should be renamed social participatory benefits. So all of that I found interesting, and I'm sure we'll reflect on. Similarly, the Child Poverty Action Group had many suggestions about the transition to PIP, for example, saying we should dramatically reduce the use of face-to-face assessments, ensure all assessments are performed by appropriately qualified people, and so on. So I think there are lots of really useful suggestions that actually don't have financial implications as well as those that do have. Now, moving on and sticking with the Child Poverty Action Groups, we forget that lots of smaller benefits, such as maternity grants, for example, will be devolved, and they're emphasising that the delivery of those should be linked with health services and made automated as far as possible. Marie Curie, as we would expect, emphasised that all devolved benefits should continue to include a system of fast tracking for terminal illness and also for the carers of terminally ill people. So lots of suggestions, I think, for us to reflect on. But can I end with two final concerns? One parent family in Scotland raised the concern that any additional carers' benefits, such as announced by the Scottish Government, might be taken into account in calculating entitlement to means-tested benefits. And of course, that interrelates with the more general point that John Swinney has made in his letter to the Secretary of State for Scotland. So we still need some clarity about that issue, because we don't want extra money spent by from the Scottish Parliament budget to simply result in deductions from the individuals who are receiving it, deductions from their income in other ways. So that's a very important point. But finally, I think, and Kevin Stewart obviously made this point, we have to set all this within the context of the size of the budget. And there are two issues here, not just the amount of money that is transferred in 2017. I think that will be relatively simple to calculate. Presumably, for example, whatever percentage of the DLA PIP budget we have in 2017, at that point we will get that money transferred and an equivalent reduction in our grant. But what happens subsequently is absolutely crucial. What will the mechanism be for adjusting the budget? And that presumably will be discussed as part of the fiscal framework. We have a more or less agreed decision in relation to taxation and how there will be indexing for the income tax. There's still some controversy about that, but I think there's general agreement about the way forward there. There isn't such agreement on the way forward for adjusting the welfare budget. And for example, David Bell makes an interesting point in his submission. He says if the indexation mechanism takes account of Scotland's growing share of the elderly population, then the risk that claims in Scotland could only be funded by diverting from funds from other priorities would be avoided. So that's one issue perhaps that the Scottish Government should be arguing for. And of course, that reminder of Scotland's growing share of the elderly population is something, of course, that featured prominently in debates around the independence referendum. So I don't want to spoil the tone of this debate, but I think we should just remind ourselves that when Kevin Stewart is assuming full devolution of the social security system and beyond that independence would suddenly solve all these problems and be a panacea, well, of course, that is where we fundamentally disagree, because rerunning the arguments of the referendum, I think for some of us the main objection to independence was actually the situation in relation to social security and other issues would actually be worse financially, although no doubt we might make more enlightened decisions.
Thank you very much. I do have a bit of time in hand, but perhaps not as much as 3 minutes for each member. Christina McKelvey to be followed by Mark MacDonald.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. Presiding Officer, as a member of the Welfare Reform Committee, there is one unescapable fact. The austerity agenda is at the cost of the most deserving and the most vulnerable in our society. All of the supposed reforms are specifically designed to cut the already limited support available to people who, for a whole range of different reasons, find themselves not fit for work, not able to take on full-time employment, struggling on zero-hours contracts, or to take on any form of ability to even find work, whether they're either medically or mentally able to do that work either. And people have come to the committee and shared their personal stories, and I have to pay tribute to all of them who have been, you know, shown some absolute bravery to come along and share their personal circumstances. That is not easy in any circumstance, never mind in front of a committee of this Parliament. But each and every one of them have asked, in the main, for one thing: a decent standard of living. And maybe instead of cutting benefits, especially in-work benefits, the Chancellor should look at the announcement made in Canada recently of a basic income supplement pilot, a social safety security net, they're calling it, to stop families falling further into poverty. And the main focus of that is that people need, this is the agreed criteria, people need secure and safe housing, food and a reasonable standard of living. On the 25th of November, the Chancellor has declared that in his spending review, he will deliver his intentions. And while the action date may be shifted a bit, we should be under no illusion about what lies ahead. Feeding in and adding to the confusion of all the complex issues around the Scotland Bill, the 200 amendments, all of the amendments that weren't supported, that were put forward by the SNP MPs. The government's refusal to admit any serious change that might bring the devolution of welfare powers to Scotland any nearer. And the most telling of all, presiding officer, the bill would allow us to top up existing benefits, but not to control the system. Where people have already have benefits withdrawn, we need clarity on what we can actually do. And we need still more clarity on whether any of the top-ups that we give will be clawed back. We do not have that clarity. There will be 80,000 Scottish families who will lose their benefits in April next year. This is the ongoing problem of the no-detriment clause. The Scottish Government's budget will continue to be reduced by Westminster, and we will continue to be denied the opportunity to raise any revenue of our own without it being clawed back by the Treasury. The fiscal framework needs to work for Scotland, and I'm hoping that the Cabinet Secretary, John Swinney, is working extremely hard, and I'm sure he is, to ensure that that does work for the framework we need in Scotland. But within the current framework, the Scottish Government is achieving a great deal in terms of helping to mitigate the bedroom tax, the provision of the Scottish Welfare Fund and other funds that pay emergency payments to families in dire need. But without that support, can you imagine what that situation would be like for those families? It would be even more critical than it is now, and that's what we see at our committee every single week. We may get the power over to vary taxes, but we won't have the power to define them. Taxes will not be devolved, and if we can raise additional revenues in Scotland, those will simply be deducted from the block grant, which of course continues to be drastically reduced every year. That's what no detriment actually means to us. We need to give this Scottish Government the ability to raise revenues independently and without interference from the Treasury. Income tax. We know we're getting some income tax involved, but it's a very blunt instrument in how to deal with poverty in our society today. And presiding officer, at the Welfare Reform Committee on Tuesday, Professor Alan Trench from the Institute of Public Policy Research pointed out the whole situation is totally opaque and incoherent, which is another theme we have heard from everyone who's given evidence to the committee. The incoherence, they're calling it the ragged edges. That's not the way to build a system. So even with the power to top up benefits, the logistics of doing so are complex and very, very expensive. HMRC would charge just under £10 for every transaction, and each application may require at least 4 transactions a year. The additional costs would be massive. There are 349,000 Scottish families receiving tax credits. Such a tax would cost, the transaction tax would be £140 million a year. Now, I don't know about you, presiding officer, and my colleagues in this chamber, but I would rather that was spent frontline on people, not on a transaction tax. So we need to identify ways to bring about cultural change as well. The cultural change that stops seeing people written off as scroungers, as lazy or as wasters. We need a system that puts dignity and respect at its heart. What happens to my constituents, presiding officer, I know it will be true of many of my colleagues in the chamber, is that through no fault of their own, the rules and priorities have suddenly been changed. And it could happen to any of us. None of us are immune to the kind of change in our circumstances. So in building a new social security system for Scotland, for those who already have long-term or even terminal conditions, would we force them to go through mandatory reassessment? I would hope not. What about creating a system that strives for better first decisions based on good assessments to stop the merry-go-round of appeals? Surely that is better than stripping people of their dignity and throwing them into a current system that shows them no respect. What about a key worker system that allows one point of contact and a form-filling point of contact to ensure individuals are getting the correct support? Surely doing that first is the best way to do it. And when it comes to employment, why is the work programme contracted out to the private sector, making huge profits on the backs of those individuals furthest away from the job market? Is just not acceptable. Surely it would be better handled by a Scottish Government agency such as Skills Development Scotland, then supported by our brilliant organisations in the third sector. They know what the employment landscape is like. As SCVO pointed out in its submission to the committee, and I quote, we need to put people at the heart of employability support. While paid employment remains one of the best ways in which people can take control over their lives, solely focus on getting people into jobs is a mistake. SCVO believes that we need to value all forms of contribution, not just jobs, and not just to tailor support to each citizen's capabilities. We have to do that. This includes the role as parents, carers, volunteers, learners and activists. The primary goal of employability support should not simply be how we get people into paid work, any kind of paid work, as soon as possible. We need to give them good, valuable paid work. Presiding officer, with Westminster's austerity agenda paramount in that place, any human or compassionate interest is rejected. And that's where we can make that change here. As a society, as a community, you know, this is a very dangerous and unhealthy position to be in. And I hope this chamber just doesn't buy it and brings about a system that puts people at the heart and gives them the rights and the responsibilities, but also the opportunities to have that one thing that the people have asked us to do for them, is to give them a decent standard of living.
Many thanks. And I now call on Mark MacDonald to be followed by Margaret MacDougall. A generous 7 minutes.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. I suppose I should declare at the outset that my son is a recipient of Disability Living Allowance and my wife a recipient of Carers Allowance. So the issues and arguments and discussions that relate to the benefit system, its interaction with individuals and changes that are taking place and how it is administered are not germane to me. They're very much part and parcel of our everyday life. And one of the issues that I've been considering, because we're in the process of reapplying for my son's disability living allowance, is that element of reapplication and reassessment that many individuals and families have to go through, not just for disability living allowance, but for eligibility for other benefits. And it takes a long time. And it doesn't take a long time because necessarily the size of the form, although that is a consideration. It takes a long time because there's no other way to put it, Presiding Officer. It's utterly soul-destroying to have to fill in a form of multiple pages explaining all the things that your child is incapable of doing. And that is an emotional burden that for many families results in them taking a very long time to complete these forms and as a result losing out on entitlements as a consequence, because obviously until reapplication goes through, entitlements cannot then be picked up again. So the longer it takes for a family to go through that process, the longer it will then take for them to receive the benefits to which they are entitled. Now, I don't know if there's an easy answer to that, Presiding Officer. One thing which strikes me as something that should be looked at is whether the reassessment and reapplication process should involve some form of advising whether there have been any changes since the application was last made, which could be backed up by health professionals or others. That is something I think would be worthy of investigation. I make no commitment or comment other than that, but I think it's certainly something that would merit investigation, which would perhaps reduce some of that emotional burden, but also reduce the length of time that for many individuals it can take to fill in these applications. Now, other members have talked about the issue around interactions between benefits, and that is an issue that I think is going to be extremely important for us to consider as these powers come into being and as policy and thinking around it develops. Because while as Annabel Goldie I think highlighted, in terms of the sums of money involved, around 2.5 to 2.75 billion pounds is going to be devolved in terms of welfare responsibility, there's still going to be around £15 billion that will remain reserved at Westminster. And some of those benefits, particularly in relation to universal credit, are dependent on interactions of benefits, interactions around income. And Christina McKelvey, I think, was entirely right to focus on the question of clawback. And I noted during the debate at Westminster on Monday that when specifically asked by my colleague Mary Black MP as to whether he would categorically state that any additional top-up would not be clawed back or would not be categorised as income and be subject to clawback, the Secretary of State did not answer directly to that question. He did not rule that out. And I think that is something that merits further investigation. Indeed, I understand that the Devolution and Further Powers Committee letter, which has been published this afternoon, asks the Secretary of State to give clarity in regards to that. And that then would lead to a question around how that is going to be assessed. And I think looking at today's announcement around HMRC, I think one of the very real considerations and concerns that we should have is the impact that the decision around HMRC and the job losses that are going to be experienced at HMRC will have on the capacity and ability of HMRC to undertake some of those what will potentially be very complicated calculations and assessments around decisions that have been taken here in Scotland and how those interact in terms of an individual's benefit entitlement and what role they will have to play with alongside the DWP. So these are considerations that are going to need to be fleshed out in order for us to ensure that the powers that we have can first of all be used to benefit the people we want to see benefit from them, but secondly, to ensure that any decision making around those is able to be done properly and is not necessarily constrained, hamstrung, or at the very worst, mismanaged as a result of a lack of available staff and available time to undertake those assessments. There's another question mark which arises, particularly in relation to those areas of reserve benefit where we have the ability to top up, leaving aside the issue of potential clawback and income. And that is how new claimants would be assessed and addressed. Because obviously, where a benefit is reserved, eligibility for that benefit will be the determination of DWP and UK ministers. It will not be the determination of Scottish ministers. And therefore, while there are those who perhaps will lose eligibility for benefits as a result of welfare reforms, but this Parliament has the ability to either top up or mitigate in those areas, if individuals in the future who would have qualified but are no longer able to even begin to qualify, there's a question around a disparity there that would again need to be examined and need to be addressed. Now, that is not to say that there isn't there is not things that can and have been done in Scotland to support the most vulnerable. And we've spoken about the mitigation of bedroom tax, the establishment of the welfare fund, the council tax benefit replacement that was put in place. We also have areas within our own responsibility, such as kinship care payments and educational maintenance allowance, where we have seen very clear statements of intent from government and also funding to follow that. But even in these areas, there are questions around how future interactions around universal credit will be handled. And I think the other thing that we need to bear into consideration is around personal independence payments and PIP. Because one of the very clear statements that we made in advance of the debate was that any rollout of PIP should be halted until it was devolved, which would have enabled us the opportunity to shape our own system according to what we felt the needs of the population were. That hasn't happened. And one of the difficulties that is going to be faced in the future, and this is, you know, this is irrespective of who forms the government at future points, is around the difficulties that are faced when you inherit a system and have to then look at potentially reshaping it. And given that many people will have gone through the very difficult process of having their benefit entitlements reassessed, reevaluated, reformed, the difficulties that could be faced around redesigning a system in very short order after that, versus the ability to design your own system and put in place your own system. So that's another difficulty and another consideration that is going to be faced. And underpinning all of that is the issue around the fiscal framework, which Mr. Rowley rather uncharitably suggested was an entirely secret process, when the Deputy First Minister has said he's willing to discuss with opposition parties the areas they want to they want more clarity on, and also which will be subject to scrutiny by this Parliament. By this Parliament's committees in due course. So there are questions around that, and I think the point of agreement I would have with Mr. Rowley and with Mr. Chisholm, who's made the point in previous debates, is that what we must ensure is that fiscal framework ensures that the powers are deliverable, but also ensures that Scotland is not hamstrung and loses out as a consequence. And I think if we're approaching it on that basis, and it seems that we have unity of purpose in regard to that, that can help make a very strong case, I think, to the Secretary of State to ensure that he brings forward a fiscal framework that we can sign up to, we can agree with, and that can ensure that the powers can be used for the benefit of the people of Scotland.
Thanks. Many thanks. Now call on Margaret McDougall, to be followed by Joan McAlpine. A generous 7 minutes.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The Scotland Bill will give this Parliament, for the first time significant powers over social security, and I welcome the work of the Welfare Reform Committee on this matter and congratulate them on focusing on how these powers could be implemented to deliver a fairer social security system for the people of Scotland. This Parliament already has huge powers over Scottish public services, but the devolution of social security powers will mean that members in the next term of this Parliament will have greater powers than ever to deliver a step change in our efforts to reduce poverty and tackle inequalities. Not only do the changes allow us to put tackling these issues at the core of our social security policy, they will also allow us to develop a uniquely Scottish policy that can be tailored to local and individual circumstances, one that is simpler and quicker to deliver and accessible to everyone who needs it. For example, with the devolution of the work programme, we can look to devolving it even further to local authorities, who can then tailor it for their own area. However, we will need to consider how this will function given the responsibility for job centres remains reserved. We should also be looking to adopt a bottom-up approach rather than a top-down approach. One size does not fit all, and under a Scottish social security system, we need to move away from that approach and, where possible, move to a more tailored support that meets the specific needs of an individual. With this in mind, we should be looking to humanise our social security policy, developing a joined-up approach. Far too often, people fall through the cracks, and those with complex needs should have a key worker rather than numerous points of contact, as it is at present. Promoting more joined-up thinking needs to start now. If we wait until the powers actually come to this Parliament, it will already be too late. In addition to this, we should be developing a person-centric welfare policy that supports people and is receptive to their needs, not one that is target-driven. We should be focusing on helping people get back on their feet, supporting them in getting over a difficult period in their lives, whether it be finding work or recovering from an illness. It needs to be a system that promotes respect and dignity rather than demonising those who fall on hard times through illness or through disability or having lost their job. As the Poverty Alliance stated in their submission to the Welfare Committee, there has been, and I quote, a marked increase in the use of stigmatising and divisive language by both politicians and the media, end quote. In Scotland, we'll have a chance to reverse this. With these powers, we will have an opportunity to place dignity and respect at the heart of our social security system and, crucially, restore trust. In particular terms, in practical terms, this debate has been highlighted over the past few weeks due to the Tory government's proposed tax credit cuts. Currently, around 11,500 families in North Ayrshire could be affected by the Tory tax credit cuts, and I believe that we should be doing everything we can to protect these hard-working families. The new powers will allow us to do something about it. They will allow us to make the choice to reverse these cuts by top-up benefits, and Scottish Labour will do just that. So I urge the SNP to sign up to joining, to doing the same. We will have the power, we just need the political will to do things differently. Just as we came together on Trident and the trade union bill, we should now come together in saying no to these tax credit cuts and reversing them if they do go ahead. Grandstanding doesn't protect the most vulnerable in our society. It's time to show that we can do things differently in Scotland, and this should happen once the Scotland Bill is passed. And once it is passed, we will have clarity around the range of the powers coming to this Parliament and, crucially, what we can do with them. However, as I said earlier, we shouldn't wait till the Scotland Bill has received royal assent. We should be setting out our plans now, not just on what we will do with the new powers, but setting out a positive vision for the future of welfare. I'm almost finished, but if you wish.
Mark MacDonald.
I'm grateful to the member giving way. I certainly agree that where it is possible to outline plans and proposals at present, we should seek to do so, or at least to develop thinking. However, would she also agree that, given that we have the autumn budget statement to come and there will be further changes undoubtedly before these powers are transferred here, that some of that thinking is going to have to be ongoing in its development because the grounds are going to shift before these powers come to this Parliament?
Margaret MacDougall.
Well, I think that's what I'm saying, that we need to start thinking about it now. We can't wait until it's upon us. We need to have some sort of plan on what our new social security system will look like. So we should be setting out a positive vision for the future of welfare in Scotland. We need a welfare system that moves away from targets and puts people, dignity, respect and trust at the very heart of it. Thank you.
Many thanks. That's good. So now call on Joan McAlpine to be followed by Roderick Campbell. A generous 7 minutes.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I want to begin with a quote from Bill Scott from the charity Inclusion Scotland on the system that we are hoping to build. He said, "The system has to be based on treating every person who comes into it as a human being like any other, with dignity and respect. That is missing from the current system, which is all about saving benefit spend." And so I'm very, very pleased to hear that the government is mirroring his words in terms of the system that we hope to design, because as a member of the Welfare Reform Committee, as colleagues have said, it's very clear from the evidence that we have received that the UK system doesn't treat people with dignity and respect. In particular, the need for face-to-face assessments and repeat assessments of people requiring PIP is unacceptable. And Mark MacDonald spoke very movingly about his personal experience. I also have personal experience of that through a member of my family. And I think just the act of receiving the form and the telephone calls is just incredibly stressful when you've got a relative who you know is not going to get better and their condition's not going to improve. And that's something I think that needs to be tackled. And we shouldn't have these repeat assessments, and the lack of weight giving to the views of medical professionals in the PIP assessment has been repeatedly mentioned in committee and is clearly something that has to change. There were some interesting suggestions made in the committee with regards to disability benefits, and that the approach taken, for example, by NHS occupational therapists is the way that you should go about assessing an individual. You should be asking, what does this person need to live with dignity? That should be the basis of the approach. As others have said, the excessive complex form filling is completely unacceptable. It's unacceptable that most people couldn't fill in a PIP assessment currently without professional support. And I'm sure that we can design something that's simpler and much less stressful. Having said that, the piecemeal devolution of benefits in this area means that we can only make part of the disabled person's experience better, because of course they will continue to have to apply for employment support allowance, and they'll continue to have to be put through many of the humiliating and the downright dangerous work capability assessments that come as part of that. And of course, as others have said, by the time we receive these benefits, 20% of the funding will have been cut, and that represents a huge challenge. As to how these benefits are delivered, a number of people in the debate today have referred to a joined-up approach and the role of local government, and that's absolutely understandable. However, I would refer them to submissions to the committee by a whole range of charities, including CPAG, Inclusion Scotland, Enable, who are very opposed to these benefits being administered by local authorities, and not just administered but actually shaped by local authorities. And I think I should quote CPAG on PIP, Disability Living Allowance, Attendance Allowance and Carers Allowance. And their submission says, "CPAG strongly believe the responsibility for disability and carers benefits should be held at Scottish national level, and it should not be devolved to local authorities. The risks associated with localisation of benefits are well documented, for example, in relation to England's local welfare assistance scheme. Previously administered at UK level, devolution of this discretionary scheme at local level has resulted in confusion, erosion of entitlement and a lack of transparency and oversight. Other submissions went even further. I mean, the submission from Inclusion Scotland actually talked about, you know, repeating the poor law and the whole idea of the parish deciding how much money you were entitled to. And I have to say, since I've come to this parliament, it's struck me that it's one of the key things that we're continually arguing about, this where responsibility lies between the Scottish Government and local government. And I think we need to have a grown-up debate about it. I mean, only last week I was speaking in the carers bill, and I took up the cause of carers charities who very strongly believe that the criteria to assess eligibility for carers' benefits should be set at national level. And I know the current position of the government is to work with councils that it's set at local level. I very much believe that it should be set at national level, and I hope that we can get to that. And I think those kind of tensions will continue to be repeated when we start looking at how we administer disability benefits in Scotland. And I would just think, I think we need to take that on board and maybe look at examples from other countries in Europe where we can set a national eligibility criteria, but obviously it's administered more at a local level because that's obviously a practical thing to do. But I just definitely don't think that we should allow that to be hung up on ideology, and it's what the disabled people and the claimants are the people who really have to determine and shape how this system is operated. I also welcome the work programme being developed, and I believe that we can make that better too. The witnesses we heard at committee described very negative experiences of the work programme, as colleagues have outlined. They talked about the feeling bullied, and in one case being reduced to tears, and in other cases that the actual work programme stopped them moving into work. And during a follow-up session to some of that very emotional evidence, we spoke to the private companies who deliver the work programme, and I was really shocked that when I quoted some evidence to these private companies about the number of people on employment and support allowance on the work programme who found a job as compared to those who were sanctioned. Official figures show that 14,000 people on employment and support allowance on the work programme found a job up to March 2014, but 41,000 of those people on ESA on the work programme received a sanction. So basically what that means is that a disabled person on the work programme was three times as likely to be sanctioned as they were to find a job. And I was very shocked when putting that to Working Links in particular, they defended the sanctions regime. And I've now written to Ian Duncan-Smith asking him to review these contracts, which have already been extended to 2017. And I would echo the comments made by colleagues that when we do get control of the work programme, I personally, and I think that view is shared by several other members of the committee, don't think that profit-driven companies should be put in charge of these programmes, and I would like to see them delivered either by non-profit organisations or by government itself. As with disability, even if we design the best possible alternative to the work programmes here, sanctions remain reserved. And I think the fact that the UK government explicitly singled out sanctions in the bill as something that we couldn't ameliorate and couldn't top up, I kind of think that kind of reflects, in a way, the whole approach to the devolution of some of these welfare benefits by the UK government, that they're saying that devolving welfare, but they really want to keep hold of that punitive culture, which is the kind of defines their welfare to work and their approach to welfare, which very much imported from the US, and it's extremely punitive. Finally, if I've just got the chance, I would just
can carry
say,
on for a little yet.
Yeah, thank you very much, Presiding Officer. Just to return, other people have discussed the whole issue of tax credits at length. I would just like to, you know, make a point that Alec Rowley mentioned quite rightly his constituents at Amazon and the difficulties that they face around Christmas, and the variability in income and how that can be addressed. That would seem to me to be an obvious reason to devolve universal credit, because it's universal credit that will help us to tackle the difficulties experienced by those people and the difficulties experienced by people in receipt of tax credits. And that's why I was very disappointed that Labour chose to vote with the Tories at Westminster not to devolve universal credit. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. Much appreciated. Now call on Roderick Campbell, a generous 7 minutes.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. As a non-member of the committee, I welcome the opportunity to contribute to this debate on the future of social security in Scotland. Whilst we may have differing views on the extent to which this Parliament should have control of welfare, there's no doubt that the Scotland Bill does provide an opportunity for this Parliament. Presiding Officer, any social security system ought to exist to protect the most vulnerable in society, and we should measure its success by its ability to do so. We must, however, get these new powers on social security right. We must design a system which puts dignity and respect first and adopts a person-centred approach, as my colleague Kevin Stewart has so powerfully suggested earlier on. We need, as a Parliament, however, to commit ourselves to powers that make a difference. And we have to accept that we operate in an environment where the Westminster Government, far from enhancing welfare, is intent on making £12 billion worth of cuts UK-wide. The Scotland Bill will see us gain responsibility for over 11 benefits worth £2.5 billion a year. We will also gain powers to top up those entitled to benefit payments and create new benefits. It's a step in the right direction. If I may, I would like to say a few words first about employment and the work programme. With regard to employment, we must continue the good work that we are doing in relation to Fair Work, the living wage, and creating an effective and viable Scottish alternative to the work programme. People must be placed firmly at the heart of it. That's why it's important that the Scottish Government continues with its public discussion amongst service users, communities, businesses, training providers and trade unions on how best to tackle existing challenges that employers and those looking for work face. It's only by listening to these groups that we can shape our future employment services to the needs of job seekers and to the needs of the wider Scottish economy. Presiding Officer, the devolution of the work programme and work choice is an opportunity to improve the fortunes of the most vulnerable Scots. However, there are significant obstacles to overcome. As members will be aware, the committee heard from participants of the work programme who have suffered because of how the programme currently operates. The committee heard painful stories about how participants throughout their engagement with the work programme have lived in constant fear of being sanctioned and the consequent physical and mental effects that has had. Quite worryingly, however, the sanction aspect of the work programme will remain reserved to Westminster, meaning that we as a Parliament are powerless to protect vulnerable Scots from sanctions. In his evidence to the committee this week, I think that Mark Willis of the Child Poverty Action Group stated that, quote, as we have seen, sanctions are imposed quite unfairly in many cases, and a lot of sanctions decisions are overturned. There are huge concerns and much evidence of inappropriate use of sanctions. Presiding Officer, the decision to retain sanctions at Westminster will create another problem. Confusion, as Kevin Stewart's already referred to. The evidence of Tanya Gilchrist of the Shaw Trust was that it would certainly cause confusion. And there's certainly a case for the devolution of Job Centre Plus, and it's a shame that that's being missed. And I agree once again with my colleague Kevin that the system could be further improved. The conditionality aspects of the work programme were also devolved. The negative experiences... Oh, I'll take an intervention there. Yep.
Alex Johnston.
Given that we've got a wee bit of time in this debate, I suspect, I wondered if the member would take the opportunity to explain if he, as many of his colleagues, is so opposed to sanctions. Does he imagine a benefit system that would have no kind of measures within it in order to ensure that people engage in the process?
No, my own view is obviously we need to give thought to how this progresses, but I think we should be talking about carrots rather than sticks. The negative experiences of participants on the work programme is an indication that a future Scottish work programme must take account of individual circumstances and requirements. And we must examine the evidence to understand what's worked well and what could be done better and build such lessons into the design and commissioning of future services.
If I may, I'd like just to turn to carers' allowances. We heard this morning in the press about the contribution that unpaid carers make to our society, estimated by the University of Sheffield to be saving the UK taxpayer £132 billion, involving 6.8 million volunteer carers. And for most of us, contributing time in particular to looking after other members of our family is something we positively embrace. But we need to recognise that carers need support. Carers' allowance is, as we know, one of the lowest of all working benefits. And the announcement in October that the Scottish Government will increase carers' allowance is therefore, in my view, to be warmly welcomed. Carers Scotland, while expressing disappointment that carers' allowance was not, that carers' benefits were not to be fully devolved to the Scottish Parliament, nevertheless took the view that the structure of carers' allowance could be improved under the Scotland Bill. And we ought to ensure that access to carers' allowance and understanding of it is improved so that carers and their families get the financial support they need. But I'm also mindful of the evidence that Richard Mead of Marie Curie gave to the committee in September when he indicated, I think with force, that health, social care and welfare systems frequently fail carers, particularly those who are caring for someone at the end of life, yet carers are often amongst the most important parts of that package. So in any new system, I think we should take account of concerns such as those expressed by Marie Curie. But it will cost money, and let's remember that money spent on carers' allowance will not be available to spend elsewhere. That's why it's so important, indeed crucial, to ensure that the fiscal framework to go with the bill is fair and workable. My colleague Christina McElvey was quite right to mention the importance of the detriment principle. If only to look at what the Scottish Government is doing now, however, to understand why many of us take the view that Social Security is better in the hands of those who live and work in Scotland. And most recently, the Scottish Government began work to administer Scottish and Northern Irish Independent Living Fund service users' awards. This was necessary after the UK Independent Living Fund was terminated by the previous Conservative and Liberal Democrat administration. ILF, of course, provides financial support to individuals with a range of impairments to live their lives within the community. This funding helps them exercise choice and control and enables them to live as independently as possible with the right support. We've heard already references to the Scottish Welfare Fund. That's obviously an experience that the Scottish Government has at the present time, and that's helped more than 164,000 vulnerable households since it began. This indicates, in my view, that we have a commitment in Scotland to welfare, and we have a track record that we can build on. I sincerely hope that we'll build on that track record in exercising the new powers. Moving forward, we will need to look at practical suggestions about how the new Social Security powers may be used. Discussions throughout the third sector indicate that a new coherent approach to policy making is required, which can integrate new and existing powers. And the third sector has also been clear that those who will be affected by the new powers should be involved in that design, a suggestion I believe to be eminently sensible. To conclude, Presiding Officer, this bill in relation to welfare will open a new chapter in Scotland and one where I hope Scotland can lead the way. Thank you.
Many thanks. And we now move to closing speeches, and I invite members who have taken part in the debate to return to the chamber, if they are so minded, please. I now call on Annabel Goldie. Generous 7 minutes, Ms. Goldie.
Deputy Presiding Officer, thank you. This has been a genuinely interesting and constructive debate, and I'm grateful to the Welfare Reform Committee for making it possible. I thought the convener, Hugh Henry, got the debate off to an excellent start with both the tone and the content of his contribution. Indeed, his willingness to share his speech with us in advance of the debate I thought was a very welcome and helpful innovation, because it sets some sensible and useful parameters to help to focus attention on key points and challenges. And in fairness, I think a number of contributors have welcomed the spirit of that overture, and they have responded positively, not least the Minister Margaret Burgess. Malcolm Chisholm, I thought, made some important points, and I thought Mark MacDonald made some very reflective points and posed some persuasive arguments. Because there is an exciting but formidable challenge confronting political parties and this Parliament as to how in Scotland we plan, provide and deliver social security under the new powers in the Scotland Bill. And we are talking about a welfare budget of £2.7 billion. So let me talk about ethos. Whatever that system is, whatever benefits it is responsible for delivering, I think we shall probably have our own distinctive Scottish way of doing it. We can do things differently, and I suspect we will choose to do that. I thought it useful. Certainly, Mr. Henry.
No, Hugh Henry. I thank her for her comments. One of the things that she heard this afternoon, Presiding Officer, was a concern that if those new powers that will become available to us are used to make payments, for example, to top up benefits otherwise lost, that it may result in a clawback from Westminster. Could she perhaps maybe use the kind of privileged position that she's in elsewhere to seek some clarity on that on behalf of the committee?
So I thank Mr. Henry for making that point, and I was interested because it was raised, and my understanding is that there would be no attempt to claw back, that the universal credit provision would be provided integrally in its own right. But it is a point that I will seek to clarify, Mr. Henry, for you. I thought that a useful starting point in this debate was the list of principles to which Hugh Henry referred. And other contributors mentioned that. Dignity, respect, mentioned by Joan McAlpine, having a person-centred system, and Margaret McDougall talked about that. Making sure that we base our system on human rights, making sure it's passported with eligibility for one benefit automatically leading to qualification for others, and making it simple with documentation in plain English. And I thought Mark MacDonald particularly made a very telling contribution in that respect. I think all of this, Deputy Presiding Officer, gets to the heart of what we do in creating our new Scottish social security system, because that's where we're getting to. That is the brand that we are talking about, and that is why I was interested in the Minister's take on that point. I must say it's difficult to see how that brand operates without then concomitant political responsibility and accountability. So to me, the logical consequence of that is a minister in this parliament with responsibility for welfare and probably a parliamentary committee as well. But a delicate balance has to be struck, Deputy Presiding Officer. Whatever benefits are devised, we need to have structures, mechanisms in place for delivery which are efficient and certainly are cost effective. And if some structures already exist, such as local authorities, it may be possible to use them, and the Scottish Welfare Fund is a good example. But Joan McAlpine, I thought, posed a number of interesting points about some benefits perhaps being better administered nationally, and I think these are genuinely important issues that we need to reflect upon. It also is the case that the DWP will continue to have a presence throughout Scotland delivering universal credit, and of course the question that raises in my mind is, do we really want to replicate the DWP presence in all our communities by setting up a separate Scottish Social Security office? To me, in terms of sensible use of resource, that seems unwise, but as to how we take that forward, I think that's, again, a matter for discussion. And then there's a challenging period of transition, because that will require cooperation with DWP. Looking particularly at employability, work training, work programmes, it's worth reflecting that in most local communities, local authorities carry responsibility for economic regeneration, local schools educate, colleges respond to both educational provision and the needs of the local economy, and responsibility for business rates may be returning in some form to local authorities. So in that context, while I accept there may be a need for an overall Scottish Government framework, delivery of these programmes might be much more effective at local level. Deputy Presiding Officer, what I think is clear is the need for flexibility if these new powers are to work to best effect for the recipients of the support. And where we have existing physical presences throughout Scotland, it seems to me to make sense to try and harness that, delivering or devolving, where possible, decision-making and delivery of the provision to as local a level as possible. Now, on the powers we shall have in relation to universal credit, I have to say I'm very sympathetic that if the claimant wants the housing element to be paid direct to the landlord, let's do that. And I think there should be flexibility about to whom the universal credit is paid. And if a fortnightly payment is easier for some recipients, again, why not do that? Because to me, the really important factor is to find out what works best for a household, what maximises their ability to budget, and what minimises the prospect of difficulty in managing their finances. Deputy Presiding Officer, the Scotland Bill allows the topping up of benefits. It allows for the creation of new benefits in areas of devolved responsibility. It provides flexibility in relation to setting income tax bands and rates. That includes a nil band if that is financially affordable. And these are very wide powers. And I appreciate in this Parliament different parties may have different approaches to how they wish to both deploy and use these powers. But it does seem to me, and I would say this to the convener of the committee, that we need to exercise some caution, and I think if it's possible we should try and find some agreement across parties about structures and mechanisms and process before we plunge into specific proposals as to which of the new powers to invoke and in what form. Because the latter inevitably raises political choices, but the former need not do that. And I hope the Welfare Reform Committee can continue, Deputy Presiding Officer, to facilitate this positive discussion, because I actually think this has been a very good debate. I think some very sensible points have emerged. I think there is a recognition that we're in new territory, that we have to be both exploratory and ambitious, but we have to be sensible. And I think if the Welfare Reform Committee can be the fulcrum for that discussion, then there is scope for a continuing and, I hope, constructive and positive dialogue.
Many thanks. I now call on Alec Rowley. Generous 7 minutes, Mr Rowley.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I also welcome the debate that we've had this afternoon, and I think that there's been a real positive contribution, a real desire to create a social security system in Scotland that builds on and improves what's already there, and hopefully that recognises that that social security system can be used as part of a joined-up approach to tackle inequality and poverty across Scotland. And if we can start maybe with the points that Joe McAlpine made, because I think there was some important points there around localism and local government. I certainly, and I've read some of the evidence that was given around local authorities actually having responsibility for the decisions on local benefits, and I actually agree with that point about the poor law and what part of Scotland. I think there has to be a Scottish-wide criteria that's put in place. So that's not what I was arguing. What I'm actually arguing about is the work programme. I'll come back to that. But in terms of the point that Joe McAlpine makes, in terms of the eligibility criteria, I absolutely agree with the point. And I have seen it in local government over many years that I was in local government, where as the financial pressure comes on local authorities, suddenly the eligibility criteria for home care, for a whole range of services, starts to be changed and starts to be tightened and tightened. And it's been a way of local authorities addressing some of the cuts and the people that are obviously on the other receiving side of that are having their services cut. It's not the right thing to do. But it is an interesting point, and it was also a point that was made in one of the briefs that was sent in, where it was stated that at present the social security budget is demand-led with no set limit on the amount of money available. This will not be the case for devolved benefits, meaning careful planning must take place to ensure benefit entitlements are sustainable going forward. And I would hate to see what I witnessed over many years in local government, where eligibility criteria keeps getting tightened and people keep falling off being eligible for some of these services just purely because of the finances and the cuts. That's been the experience in local government. But in terms of the work programme, what I would say is that if you look right across Scotland at local government, you will see some really innovative projects, some innovative works that are going on to be able to get people and support people. Far too many people, and it's a recognition that's not in place with the current work programme, which is about ticking boxes. People that are far, far removed from the labour market need, they lack, in many cases, even the basic skills, the skills for life, if you like, and it needs intense programmes that are put in place to support people. And that point has been made by a number of briefings for organisations that have come in previously. Now, there are third sector organisations out there that are very good at this work, but it needs to be coordinated, in my view, not from this Parliament and not Scotland-wide, but it needs to be looked at on a regional basis across Scotland. And local government has a key role to play in the coordination of that as part of a wider economic strategy that needs to be in place, a regional economic strategy that needs to be placed in place right across Scotland. And that's the importance, and that's the important role of the local authorities. And I would hope that the Minister would not be ruling out the local authorities having a key role to play in the strategic direction of the work programme and indeed the delivery of the work programme, and they can pull together the third sector. But importantly, if we're really going to make this work, we need to involve business and industry. And so they should be partners coming together in terms of this, and it should form part of an anti-poverty strategy in Scotland, because if we are serious about tackling inequality and tackling poverty, we need to recognise that giving people the ability to be able to get the skills and get the work is absolutely crucial. I have said time and time again that throughout the history of the labour movement, people never march for benefits, they march for jobs. They need the opportunities, they need the skills. If we're going to tackle poverty, and we need decent jobs. And the example of Amazon that I gave and Joe McAlpine referred to, you know, I speak to people that are now trying to go through the agencies to get jobs in Amazon because they're desperate. And that type of poorer employment that's there, we've got to replace. And that's why I come back to the living wage. But even the living wage on its own, Annabel Golby sums up, but she didn't talk about tax credits. And the fact is that the cuts in tax credits, and the point I think was made that George Osborne coming forward with his next round, the cuts in tax credits will drive hundreds of thousands of people in this country into further and work poverty.
I agree completely and utterly with Mr. Rowley on tax credits. What I can't understand is why the Labour Party chose to walk through the lobbies with the Tories to have tax credits remain reserved when this place, which is much more progressive, could have done much, much better if that power and the resource along with it came here.
Well, the same point was made by Jo McAlpine when she said about the universal credits and why would it not have been better to have the control over universal credits. I can only say to you that my view is that we've got to start to talk seriously about how we're going to use the powers that this Parliament has, the significant and substantial powers that this Parliament is going to have. But I'm absolutely clear about this. That's, for me, not the end of the road. I support Home Rule for Scotland. I'm absolutely clear that we're on a journey. Devolution is a journey. And if we need more powers, then we need to make the case, and we will make the case on that journey to wherever that journey eventually takes us to. But right now, I believe the people of Scotland, we've got the Scotland Bill gone through the Parliament, it's been agreed through the Parliament. We now need to start to set out very clearly how we're going to use those powers to tackle the inequality, the poverty, and share the wealth better within Scotland. And that's how we need to move forward. The point was also raised by Joe McAlpine about sanctions, and Alec Johnson comes in and makes a point, are we saying there would never be sanctions? In most walks of life, there is some type of sanction there. The point is that the sanctions that have been introduced through the welfare reforms of the Tory government are absolutely unacceptable, and you just need to meet people and families out there and communities in my constituency, in the Cow and Meath constituency, and I'm sure across Scotland, and hear their stories to know that they're barbaric. People are being picked on, people are being singled out, and people are being starved, families in this modern day being starved and driven to food banks. That cannot be acceptable. So do we oppose Tory sanctions? Absolutely, we oppose Tory sanctions. And that comes to the heart of the point that Margaret McDougall made, because Margaret McDougall's made the point that in the Scottish social security system, sitting at the heart of that has to be respect and dignity.
And that's what we need to build, that respect and that dignity. So the point that John Wilson made about it being easier to fill forms in, but also people being treated with respect and treated with dignity. I would sum up the presiding officer by just making the point that Hugh Henry made. And I would finish on this point. Hugh talked about the winter fuel allowance and the cold weather allowance. These were policies that were introduced by Gordon Brown as Chancellor, as was the tax credits. And what we need to think about is the principles that were put in place. What were the principles when these policies were put in place? In terms of the winter fuel allowance, the cold winter payments, the principle was that older people will tend to be in their houses during the winter. They're not out. They're not out working. They tend to need more heat. Therefore, they get cold. And therefore, it was right that they shouldn't have been in fuel poverty. So we need to look at some of the principles that were in there when these types of things were brought in place by the last Labour government and ensure that they stay in place, no matter the colour of the administration in this place. Thank you.
Thanks very much. I now call on Margaret Burgess. 8 minutes, please.
Okay. Thank you, Presiding Officer. And I think, like others, this has been a good debate. I think across the chamber, there's been a lot of consensus on a number of issues, particularly the type of social security system that we want to see here in Scotland, a Scottish social security system based on dignity and respect for the individual and person-centred, as Margaret McDougall mentioned. But also during this debate, I think we recognise there's opportunities with the new powers coming to this Parliament, but there's also some considerable challenges, and we can't shy away from those challenges. And there are challenges when you get partial benefits devolved. That creates real challenges, and I think Kevin Stewart and Christina McKelvey highlighted those challenges very well. And I would just say, before I respond to some of the other points that were made in terms of tax credits, which has been mentioned by a number of people, and Kevin Stewart mentioned it again there. He showed very clearly, and it was demonstrated very clearly at the Welfare Reform Committee yesterday, just the difficulties there are in having that benefit partially devolved. And I, like Kevin Stewart and others on this side of the chamber, would much have preferred to have tax credits devolved in its entirety, and that was an amendment that went to the UK Parliament on Monday, and I was very disappointed, extremely disappointed, in fact almost couldn't believe it, that Labour went through the lobby with the Tories and voted basically to retain the power to cut tax credits at Westminster, to allow the Tories in Westminster to cut tax credits at their will, and then expect the Scottish Government to make up that difference and pay for it. And I just was so disappointed at Labour's position in that, and I'm just going to say that because we've heard the difficulties that there's going to be to try and assist families, low-income families, and it's not straightforward, as was said by Christina McKelvey. She showed us very clearly and illustrated clearly the difficulties there are, and Mark MacDonald did the same in terms of trying to help those low-income families that are going to drop off perhaps in April this year. But I will now respond to some of the other points that were made. And I think Alec Rowley talked there quite a bit about localism in it, and Joan McAlpine came from another point in that. And I think that is a genuine, honest debate that we're having. The Scottish Government at the moment is looking at appraisals and for options for delivery and looking at the process. We're consulting with COSLA. We want to take time because we've got to get it right, and of course it will come to Parliament. We have had initial discussions with representatives, including COSLA, local bodies, people with expertise, knowledge as well. But any system we have, I'll take a brief intervention.
Alex Johnson.
Would the Minister agree that if we are going to trust local government to do some of this, we must trust local government to do enough of it so that we can get efficiencies in the delivery network, and that just a small bit is going to be inefficient and cost more money than it's worth?
Margaret Burgess.
I'm just going to carry on and say that any delivery has to be cost effective. We have to be aware of that. We cannot spend the money in our social security system administering it. We have to make sure the money goes into the pockets of the people who need it. So of course it has to be cost effective. It has to be a high quality service, and it also has to be very customer focused as well. I think that is the kind of service we are looking for. And we have to align delivery to local services, and if it's appropriate for any social security to be delivered through a local government, then we have to make sure it's properly aligned and that there's flexibilities to deliver it in different ways. So all of that's an ongoing discussion and something that we all have to look at. And that's one of the, it's a challenge and an opportunity as to how we take that forward. Mark MacDonald and others talked about the how we could make better use of medical evidence, and I would say that that's something we're currently looking at, how we can make the assessment process fairer and a process that people have confidence in, because we understand and we heard outlined from a number of people, I think Roderick Campbell and Joan McAlpine and others, and I think also it may have been Malcolm Chisholm, just talked about the difficulties people face getting into the system. And we need to involve the stakeholders in this, and that's another important thing of any social security system. The system has to take on board the views of those that are going to be customers of that system, and at some point we may all be that. So we are looking at that, how we can make it accessible and how it is much more customer focused. And a point that was made by a number of speakers, which I really have to say in case we don't get the opportunity, and I think it is an absolutely crucial point, and that's the point of clawback of any benefits the Scottish Government or any top-up that the Scottish Government agrees or provides. Unless we have absolute clarity, and it's not enough just to, you know, and I appreciate Annabel Goldie said she would take this up with her counterparts in Westminster, but we need to have an absolute clear commitment from the UK government that there will be no clawback, and that will be absolutely crucial to any fiscal arrangements that are made. That is, if there's any clawback, there is absolutely then, there's no benefit to the people. We're paying to administer something that is not going to help the people that desperately need the help from the system. So in that basis, that would be absolute, you know, that would be a red line for me. So I just want to say another couple of things. I see I'm not getting much time, but I think we all agree in the chamber, and I think that's useful to have that kind of commitment, that putting people at the heart of social security will go some way to lifting the fears and rebuilding trust. It also illustrates an important point, and one that I want to make again, is I believe that we all have a stake in a social security system. It's not a system that belongs to the government, it doesn't belong to an administration, it doesn't belong to local government, it belongs to each and every one of us. And we all have a stake in it, and at some point in our lives, we'll all have to, ourselves or our family or our neighbours or friends may need that system at some point. And when they do need that system, we need to have confidence in that system, and we need to know that the support will be there and there'll be no stigma attached to it. And many people face additional challenges and costs in their daily lives because of ill health or disability. And then it's right, absolutely right, that society as a whole helps to meet that challenge and we meet it together. So I hope that this is the approach that we all agree is the approach to take forward. We also want to take the chance to reinforce the government's strong record in taking action to mitigate the worst of the UK's welfare reforms to protect Scotland's citizens. And our current and planned field funding is an investment of around £296 million over the period 2013-14 to 15-16. We've mitigated the impact of the bedroom tax. We've established the Scottish Welfare Fund. We've provided £1 million of funding over 2014-16 to help combat food poverty. We've invested around £1.6 million per year since 2013-14 in the living wage across parts of the public sector where the Scottish Government controls the pay bill, and we've assisted 6,000 people with that. And I think all of that demonstrates our commitment to ensuring there's support in place, and we will continue to support vulnerable people
Minister's
and
about
communities.
To close.
I'm in my last minute? Okay, sorry, I can't give way. So I think we have to look and also look at the Scottish Welfare Fund and reflect on that. I believe it is a real success story, although the circumstances in which it's been set up reflect the damage to our communities and welfare. So I just want to make absolutely clear, as I finish, Presiding Officer, that we need to get the fiscal framework right. And the Scottish Government position is absolutely clear. We won't accept a fiscal framework that is not a fair deal for Scotland. And I hope the whole of the Chamber can agree with that. Thank you.
Many thanks. just want to thank everyone today for making the debate fit the time available. I now call on Claire Adamson to wind up the debate on behalf of the Welfare Reform Committee. You have until 5 o'clock, please.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. And I wish to thank all my colleagues in the Chamber who have contributed to this afternoon's debate. We have heard a wealth of different views, options, suggestions and indeed warnings across the Chamber today. But the common thread running throughout the contributions has been that the future of social security is a key issue of importance for the people of Scotland. While we as a committee welcome the additional social security powers that will be devolved to the Scottish Parliament, we appreciate that designing a new Scottish social security system will be, in Ms Goldie's words, a formidable challenge, particularly as the responsibility for it will still be shared with Westminster, as has been highlighted by some of the colleagues this afternoon. Despite this challenge, we do hope that the powers contained within the Scotland Bill can be used to build something that will improve greatly upon the current system and rectify the many of the failings which we have heard about during the course of our inquiry. And in doing so, go some way to resolving the hardships being faced by people around the country, hardships that we are hearing about in our surgeries and constituency offices day after day. I would like to address some of the points that have been made in the Chamber this afternoon. Our convener, Hugh Henney, laid out the principles of the bill, talking about dignity, respect, the personalisation of the system, and the importance of passporting within the new system, and it being greatly simplified. I would say that the contributions from everyone this afternoon have had that key theme of dignity and respect through every contribution this afternoon. Even Mr Johnson managed to acknowledge that some of the research recently has shown that that may be lacking in the current system. In opening, Alex Rowley laid out his commitment to tackling poverty in Scotland. Indeed, I wondered if he'd maybe been inspired by a former Prime Minister yesterday. I'm speaking, of course, of John Major. But I do think it's significant that we have had contributions from two ex-Prime Ministers talking about the importance of tackling inequality and poverty, and that this is reflected by everyone who has taken part this afternoon. When we talk about specifically about some of the specifics of the Scotland Bill, disability living allowance and personal independence payments were of huge importance. The Minister has talked about the delays that have caused such confusion, such difficulty for people who are undergoing PIP at the moment, and how that has significantly impacted on people even before those powers have been devolved to us. Mark MacDonald also highlighted that the rollout of PIP had been requested but denied to the Scottish Government, and that this indeed is causing, by the time we get control of PIP and are able to do a Scottish solution for it, many people will already have gone through reassessment, causing the stress and problems that have been highlighted by many members today. When it comes to carers' allowance, this was also of key importance to people. The Minister highlighted that carers' allowance would be being raised to the equivalent of job seekers' allowance, and Malcolm Chisholm acknowledged, and Rod Campbell also welcomed this, and also the abolition of the 84-day rule, which affected the families of seriously ill or disabled children in hospital. But many, many people, Mark MacDonald, Christina McKelvey, Malcolm Chisholm, all raised the issue of clawback, and we do need clarity in this. And I welcome that Ms Goldie has confirmed that she will try and seek that clarity, and I welcome that the Minister has highlighted that as of key importance. The work programme and work choice is, of course, a significant issue. We have heard significant evidence in the committee, and Hugh Henry highlighted this, particularly for people with disabilities in opening today. And the Minister simply said it's not working, and we know it's not working from the evidence to the committee. The access to work grants being reserved was mentioned by Malcolm Chisholm, Kevin Stewart and Joan McAlpine. And the problems for people with mental health within this system and whether they're recognised significantly and correctly within this system is also of key interest to the members. There was no consensus about how the new work programme could be delivered, with both local and national options being spoken about. But there was several members, including Christine McKelvey, mentioned the fact that the profitability of private sector being involved was something that may and should be considered. If we look at the universal credit, this has already been highlighted as a major concern in that we will have administrative responsibility for universal credit but not have this devolved to the Parliament, which means that we will be particularly constrained by the fact that sanctions remain within the auspices of the DWP, and that this will cause considerable problems in any rollout of the work programme or work choice programmes that might be developed for a specific Scottish solution. In terms of the delivery framework, as I said, we talked about local delivery, we talked about national delivery, but what seemed to be most important throughout the chamber is that we don't end up with a postcode lottery of delivery, that when local solutions may be adopted, that they are appropriate and no one loses out in that system. The Minister also talked about, and it was mentioned by many people this afternoon, Margaret McDougall, Malcolm Chisholm, Joan McAlpine, all talking about how integration and partnership working in Scotland is going to be absolutely key to getting this delivery right. Malcolm Chisholm particularly mentioning maternity grant that perhaps should lie with the NHS in terms of its delivery. So it's been a very interesting debate this afternoon. Many issues have been raised in terms of how we go forward in Scotland. I would say partnership working, engaging with the stakeholders and working together to get to a solution is of the most importance. One area that was mentioned and is key to this whole thing happening is, of course, the fiscal framework. The Minister, Alex Rowley, Malcolm Chisholm, Christine McKelvey, Mark MacDonald all expressed how important it is to get this right. Presiding Officer, it has been a privilege to take part in this debate this afternoon. I believe that those who took part in committee, in panels, in informal discussions, and who came and gave evidence, sometimes under considerable stress and difficulty, will have looked in this debate this afternoon and know that their voices have been heard. We may not all agree on the extent of the powers, and there may be genuine, but what I've seen today is genuine commitment to use what powers we get to build a clear, costed and credible Scottish social security solution that will be based on dignity, respect and built in partnership in Scotland.
Thank you, Ms Adamson. That concludes the Welfare Reforms Committee debate on the future delivery of social security in Scotland. We now move to decision time, and there is only one question to be put as a result of today's business. That question is that motion number 14560, in the name of Hugh Henry, on the future delivery of social security in Scotland, be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
The motion is therefore agreed to. That concludes decision time, and I now close this meeting.